I promise you my agent is not here today. But it is such a pleasure to come together to hear Camille Paglia speak about the dark women of Shakespeare. It is just fantastic that she's taken the time to come here and join us today. Camille Paglia is a self-described dissident feminist. She's been a professor at the University of the Arts in Philadelphia since 1984. She's been called many, many things. She's been called brilliant. She's been called outrageous. She's been called a writer in a category all her own, a radical libertarian, and an academic Rottweiler. And in 2005, Paglia was named as one of the top 100 public intellectuals by the journals Foreign Policy and Prospect. She is, of course, the author of Sexual Personae, Art and Decadence from Nefertiti to Emily Dickinson. Now, this book was written in the early 80s, and it took a decade to get it published. It was rejected by 7 publishers and 5 agents, and when it was eventually published in 1990, at what was seemed then as the height of the age of political correctness, it became not only a bestseller, it reached the 7th place on the paperback bestseller list, which is a very rare accomplishment for a scholarly book. And it was at that time, as many of you will recall, both a bombshell and also a breath of fresh air. Her other books and essays include Sex, Art, and American Culture in 1992, Vamps and Tramps in 94, Break, Blow, Burn in 2005. Her most recent book is 2012's Glittering Images, and she's a critic of American feminism and of post-structuralist theory, as well as a commentator on multiple aspects of U.S. social culture, such as its visual art, its music, and its film history. Paglia is known for her critical views of many aspects of modern culture, including, of course, feminism. Old school feminism, she says, coveting social power is blind to women's cosmic sexual power. And liberalism. Liberalism defines government as tyrant father, but demands it behave as nurturant mother. In 2012, an article in the New York Times remarked that, quote, anyone who has been following the body counts of the culture wars over the past decades knows Paglia. Her study of the classics has earned her the respect of such noteworthies as Harold Bloom, who was also her mentor. She's on the editorial board of the classics and humanities journal Orion and has been writing a monthly column for Salon.com since the late 1990s. She's currently working on a study of the visual arts intended as a companion book to Break, Blow, and Burn. And just a small reaction, a personal reaction as an artist, as I read her writing, and especially as I read the essays that accompanied the 43 poems in Break, Blow, and Burn, I'm always struck at how this particular writer doesn't use jargon, doesn't use cant. She just exhibits deep intelligence, an abundance of insight, and more than anything else, a real sensitivity to the beating heart that breathes life into a poem. Ladies and gentlemen, Camille Paglia.
Good evening, Anthony, that was fabulous. Thank you so much. So I'm talking to you today about women in Shakespeare, particularly the dark themes that are attached to women in many places. Let me just make a statement, first of all, is that I think that in general, current cultural methodologies in North America and Britain are moving in a direction that is as they affect education, are going to make young people incapable of responding to poetry, to myth, ultimately to Shakespeare, because of this, to me, very distorted view of human life, where only society is seen as worthy of study. Nature doesn't exist. Nature is simply this thing out there. We can only know it through words. We're all born tabula rasa. There are no fundamental gender differences, et cetera, et cetera. And the kind of the kind of criticism that young people are being presented with, and including in Shakespeare classes, I think is mediocre. It's fourth rate. It's derivative. I still, you know, feel a very intense connection to the great, you know, the A.C. Bradley, to G. Wilson Knight, you know, those critics of Shakespeare who were immersed in the history of poetry. And this is the thing, is that post-structuralism and post-modernism only work, if they work at all, okay, with narrative, okay, with novels, with fiction. Okay, they can do absolutely nothing with poetry because they don't understand imagery. Now, to me, Shakespeare is so clearly a man of the country. Here he is writing in the city for, you know, most of his career, but the images that come to him are drawn from his own experience, his saturation in the operations of nature, the seasons, the incredible specificity of his references in making metaphors throughout the plays. But beyond that, something that G. Wilson Knight said that knocked me out when I read it in graduate school. He said that the rhythms of the great plays of Shakespeare are elemental rhythms that are like it's a great wave motion at the most profound level of the plays, moving everything forward. So I think that it's precisely these kinds of inchoate, pre-rational, irrational forces in Shakespeare that I think that young people's ability to access these or to understand them is disappearing because of the horrible contemporary criticism that they are inflicted with. New historicism. Okay, it's a big discovery. Colonialism in the Tempest. Run up a flag. Okay, this is their one thing. Okay, and that's all. Without any sense whatever that the overwhelming political view in Shakespeare is that of a man who of a generation which still was seeing the scars of so many decades of civil war in England and coming out of a period of disorder. And so you have a really fundamentally conservative kind of politics in Shakespeare. He privileges order. He feels that that monarchy is the best form of government, and he ends all of his comedies in not just marriage but multiple marriages, where marriage itself, heterosexual marriage, is represented as a symbol of social consolidation and of harnessing nature's powers, you know, for fertility, you know, for the future. All right, so I think Canadians are so civilized that I'm not sure, okay, that there is much of a sense of the irrational here, except when there's kind of a crime that imitates our crime south of the border. But I think that I find it also in the Scandinavian countries when I talk to people from Sweden or from Norway. This is a kind of a rational sense that if we can just keep on refining and fine-tuning the social mechanism, we will get to utopia. There will be human happiness if we can just find the perfect social structure. Okay, without any sense at all that there are these deep irrational forces in human psychology and in humans operating as groups. That is what I see, okay, in human history. Okay, I've been studying, you know, the rise and fall of ancient empires since I was a child. Okay, and that's what I see. I see these great rhythms in history, this rising and falling, and so on. This idea that we can just we're all basically nice. Okay, and therefore, if we can just get along with each other, okay, and just like to make this little correction, then the sexes will like each other, and there are no fundamental differences between the sexes, etc. In fact, I think I felt anthropologically from the distance of the U.S. that was kind of going on a bit during this long soap opera about the Toronto mayor, okay. because I mean, what it looked like to me is that everyone is so rational in Canada that they could not understand irrational behavior. And so when you had irrational behavior, Canadians sort of stepped back, looked at each other, sighed, and tried to be patient, okay, but had no way of there was no conceptual framework for understanding the irrational in Canada, much less dealing with it. In the United States, there would have been a counter reaction to his irrationalism within like 3 weeks, and he would have been out, okay? So you had to put up with him on and on and on. Okay, now, let me talk to you. I'm going to talk to you about four different plays, hopefully, if I have time today. King Lear, Hamlet, Macbeth, and Antony and Cleopatra. We'll see if I can get through them all. But I want to talk, discuss the different ways that this issue of dark women or darkness in the female powers, okay, is represented in the play. Let me go quickly and immediately to a very troubling passage apparently everybody has difficulty with in the fourth act of King Lear, where Lear is now reduced to nothing, okay, on the on the heath, and is so disillusioned with his daughters and their abuse of him and so on that there's this almost like a kind of a set piece where he goes off classic expression of misogyny, almost as like something out of medieval theologians, okay, where he says about women, okay, down from the waist they are centaurs, though women all above. But to the girdle do the gods inherit. Beneath is all the fiends. There's hell, there's darkness, there's a sulfurous pit, burning, scalding, stench, consumption, fire. Right? So this is a moment when, and it happens periodically in Shakespeare's major tragedies, where someone becomes, feels that through a failure of trust in women, feels as if he has been betrayed, and you get this this condemnation of women as a class. But beyond that, I mean, this passage certainly had a great influence on my thinking as I was writing my dissertation and turned it into Sexual Persona of the Book, which is that today we are in a time, a rationalist time, with a utopian psychology, which believes that human beings are perfectible and so on, where anything like this in literature or art that reflects hatred or a war between the sexes or any kind of revulsion, disgust with the female body, that this is going to be erased from human history. It doesn't represent anything fundamental to gender differences. It's a relic of a period of patriarchy when men owned women. Anytime you get this, it's coming. This is just not what I see. What I feel that especially in major literature, that any passage that reflects this kind of a tension between, and especially an inflammatory one like this between the genders, it has some measure of truth in it. It must be confronted. Now we're in a time where, the banal, sentimentality about the vagina. Okay, that goes on. I mean, and these women coming out of Eve Ensler's The Vagina Monologues, they're not even using the word right. I mean, it's such a disgrace to women that you have putative feminists, misthinking that vulva, okay, is the same thing as vagina. Well, the word vagina means sheath, okay? That is the invisible internal organ that is there, that fits the erected penis perfectly. It's the vulva they're talking about. My vagina is beautiful. How can you see your vagina without a microscope? What are they talking about? It goes all the way back to the first phase of second wave feminism. It was like the early 70s. There were all these I can't even say the word here. It's a four letter word beginning with C. The coloring book. Okay, whatever her name was. It was so badly drawn. If it had been a little bit more artistic, fine. And you were supposed to take purple and pink and red crayons, okay, and like paint them to show how beautiful the vagina is. You're supposed to like look at yourself, et cetera. Well, in my opinion, okay, there is a fundamental kind of instability built into the history of the visual arts, because if you do indeed develop your eye, okay, for the perception of analysis of the visual arts, okay, there is, you have to use the same aesthetic judgment criteria when looking at the both male and female genitals, and both are comical and absurd, and it's been very difficult for artists throughout history to incorporate them in some way that doesn't make you giggle or flee screaming and so on. All right, so But now, here's the point. It's a point I make to my classes, which is that whenever in Shakespeare's plays you have this kind of misogyny being expressed, it represents a person, a man, who is in a state of insanity, okay, in a state of mental extremity. It is not Shakespeare speaking, except that, you know, we do see in at least one of the sonnets, and perhaps a bit more, that Shakespeare did have periods where he felt a sense of exhaustion or revulsion, exhaustion with or revulsion from sex, that there was something in sex, a kind of emptiness, sometimes in the kind of fast-track world he seemed to be inhabiting in London. There's no reference at all to his wife waiting patiently back in Stratford. And just a sense that you know that he wasn't attaining that there's a heaven to an ecstasy to sexual contact, but then a hell that happens afterwards, a total state of physical waste and a sense of disillusion and alienation, isolation, et cetera, et cetera. So, but Shakespeare obviously identified that feeling of revulsion, okay, from women or from sex, as being equivalent to, okay, almost insanity, a state of insanity, because the way this I think that it's very very telling that this play King Lear begins, okay, in a way that the way the scene is performed doesn't catch this, I think, a lot of the times. The very opening, okay, has before Lear comes out with the map and divides the kingdom up in that foolish way. You have this exchange between the Earl of Kent and the Earl of Gloucester, where the Earl of Gloucester is speaking about the way his son, okay, Edmund was conceived. And he's speaking in a very kind of like elbow in the ribs way, the way men would speak to each other in a locker room or in a bar or something like that. It's utterly gross. And the Earl of Kent, okay, the lines are so austere in the Earl of Kent's response that it's clear the Earl of Kent feels embarrassed, okay, for this. It understands that it's insulting to women, but especially insulting to Edmund, who's standing there. Okay, different productions have a choice to make with that scene to decide whether Edmund is actually hearing it or not hearing it. I personally feel that it's more effective to have Edmund not really hearing it, but standing far away enough to see that his father's body language, so gross and so, and looking at him snickering about the way this illegitimate son was conceived, and for Edmund to be processing it as if this is something that he's seen many many times before. This kind of callous barroom way of talking about women is something that Shakespeare clearly, okay, is opposed to. It's so opposed to that he opens the play with. Throughout in Hamlet also, okay, there are these moments where Hamlet turns against Ophelia and begins to berate her and denounce her and to use language that you're not sure whether Ophelia is still overwhelmed, that she doesn't really process how sexually loaded these terms are, but that she understands that she's, I mean, to speak to a beautiful young virgin in a public place with such language as Hamlet does when they're waiting for the play to start is it's insulting, okay, it's beneath the level of a prince, of Denmark. And Shakespeare is very sensitive to this matter of the dignity with which women should be spoken of in public. So again, I think that this passage of kind of in Lear, on the heath, the kind of hallucinatory misogyny, I think that it is, to me, it's an authentic vision, okay, of women's internal space, internal sexual space, identified by mythology with cave and cavern and the center of the earth and so on. I mean, I think it's something that is part of the human imagination, and the idea that somehow in our enlightened period that we're somehow going to pass a bunch of laws and have a few sexual harassment committees and so on, and it's all going to go away. I think that this is what that's saying, is that the human dream life does not exist. That there are no archetypes. Okay, we're exactly the same in the our hormones and our sexual organs and the still the burden of pregnancy falling on women, okay, and every human being emerging from this cave within a woman's body and so on, that all these things are somehow unimportant. We're not going to think about them. We're not going to allow our imagination to be troubled by them. I believe that art and myth are almost in the Jungian way, okay, it is like the collective unconscious is a projection of our internal dream life, okay? And art, great ideas in art, you know, it all flows from our dreaming, the dream process. Now, when I was in college, there was a lot of attention being paid to dreaming and analysis, various analyses of dreams. Freud's interpretation of dreams was recommended to us. We were, you know, that was it was like a whole generation that was taking drugs. I did not, okay, I'm Italian. I believe in the old-fashioned things like wine and beer and so on, and, you know, the occasional margarita today, right? This was a period that took hallucination and vision seriously. There were all the vision quests, people taking peyote and mushrooms and going off to the desert to meditate, to see visions. So what happened to that, okay? My generation, okay? Well, first of all, they destroyed their brains doing that, okay? That's number one, what happened. But that whole testimony dropped out of the culture, okay? And now we're left, okay, with these bureaucrats and these commissars, okay, who believe that politics is nothing but statism, and people in Washington, you know, have all, and the capitals of the world, they have the answers for the poor proletariat, you know, down below, et cetera. It's absolutely mad to me, okay? But this tremendous cultural loss, okay, of, again, the power of dreaming, okay, that wells up from our own unconscious every single night. Now, I don't know about the people here. Everyone here is presumably an art lover, okay? So I don't know how, as individuals, how seriously you take your dreams, but I still take my dreams extremely seriously. My grandmothers, born in Italy, still regarded dreams as prophetic, okay? They were always going, I had a dream, okay? And then you would hear the prophetic dream about disasters, okay, and so on. Sometimes after something bad happened, they would say, I had a dream about that. Okay, and so you see, it came true. It's like, and, you know, the Cumaean Sibyl, okay, who they said at Cumae all those centuries, wasn't far from, you know, my homeland. So a vision and prophecy and intuition and instinct, these are all, you know, it's very difficult to teach them, but you certainly can nurture them. I mean, this is why I've been teaching in art schools for most of my career, because I have a rapport with artists and performers who understand the need to tap their own dream lives and their own emotional lives, right? And these idiotic methodologies, post-structuralism, and postmodernism, full of irony and snark and feeling superior and so on. What are they? And this is why the arts are becoming increasingly, okay, impoverished. I have no idea what the future is for any of the arts in the U.S. right now. Okay, there's no imagination left because the imagination has been trampled on by the kinds of books these poor kids are forced to read, gobbledygook, contorted prose. Okay, instead of opening themselves passionately to art, which is what I believe in, okay? You let art work on you, okay? All right? You don't have the answers. No one has the answers to art, okay? But it's like this incredible thing that goes back and forth between you and it, and you internalize the art. It becomes part of you, etc. I mean, I'm just completely, okay, persona non grata, as you can see, an academe, okay, because of these odd and very antiquated views that art is important, okay? And that art is not the servant of any ideology, okay? All right, so... what else about, thank you. Now, let me say something about in terms of dark women, about this kind of Cinderella-like pattern in King Lear, where you have you know, Cordelia as the daughter who loves her father, and the other two who betray him. And so, you know, the problem is that, you know, Goneril and Regan, I always have a soft spot for them, okay? And I know it's not fair, but they're kind of bitchy, you know, and they're kind of like Betty Davis figures, you know, from classic Hollywood. So it's very difficult for me to. I mean, I know it's wrong. I know I kind of imbalance the play. You know, Cordelia seems to me like so 1950s, kind of like a Betty Crocker kind of a girl. I know it's wrong of me, okay? But it is totally wrong because that scene, the scene where she refuses, and you know, at the opening, to flatter her father, okay, and just says nothing. Okay, this is one of the most powerful scenes in all drama. By the way, that scene alone should prove to anyone, okay, that Shakespeare, the man from Stratford, wrote those plays. Okay, it wasn't an aristocrat sitting in a palace someplace. Okay, it wasn't some courtier. Okay, that was a man of the stage. It was an actor. Okay, who understood blocking, understood drama on the stage. Who wrote a scene like that? Okay, and she goes, you're going. Lear calls on the daughters. Okay, tell me how much you love me, daughter number one. And then she speaks, oh, I love you, I love you, I love you. All right, now, daughter number two, okay? Oh, I love you, I love you, I'm sorry. All right, now, daughter number three. And the entire audience, the court on the stage, and then the entire audience, everyone with this pressure of eyes now on this like small, frail, feminine girl, Cordelia, okay? And she holds it all off. You just have those incredible, penetrating lines of dramatic force going toward her. And she goes, nothing. What do you have to say? Nothing. Okay, and so it's like so powerful. And it's just like pure theater. I mean, Shakespeare is a genius of theater. But Goneril and Regan, because they're more active, okay, tend to, I think, sometimes get the interest. Well, and then in the Laurence Olivier TV version of it, okay, you have Goneril and Regan being played by Diana Rigg, you know, and Dorothy Tootin. Well, it's like it's fabulous, absolutely fabulous, hilarious, like soap opera vixens, okay, in this scene. But in terms of darkness, you know, dark women. Now, Goneril and Regan don't really operate as sexual beings per se, even though they end up fighting with each other over Edmund, at the end. But they're kind of trashy, okay? They don't obey the codes that govern that Shakespeare feels properly govern social classes. And and one of the best examples of it is where you have Goneril confiding too much in her steward. Now this is a detail that is often missed, okay, by contemporary productions, because we don't have a class oriented society any longer. But you do not take servants into your confidence. You don't babble to servants about the opinions of your sister, another duchess, okay, or your opinions about your father, okay, it's a strange, queasy overfamiliarity that Goneril has with her steward, okay, that it almost is processed as something. It's not sexual, although who knows what's actually going on. But there's something where she lacks a sense of borderline, okay, and she lacks a sense of propriety, okay, and so that is one form, okay, that the negative women take in Shakespeare's plays. But now, wait, I'm going to have to move more rapidly, or we're never going to. All right, we've got to move on, okay? All right, we'll never get done. All right, so now let me see about Hamlet, okay? All right, Hamlet, okay? Oh, dear. I mean, just every time I teach it, this is the thing about Shakespeare, is that, and why we have the obligation to present young people with great works of art early on, okay, and not just things that are PC and fulfill some sort of agenda for identity politics, to make a kind of cafeteria menu for them. I think that young people should be told, what are the great works of art? Expose yourself to them. Don't expect to understand them, but this is yours. It becomes it's a treasure house inside you, right? And we have to say to them, okay, evangelically, all great works of art will look different to you as you get older, as you accumulate experience. Okay, so that you like open a play or listen to something or see an artwork or even a great film, and as you get older and have different experiences and become and have relationships or children or whatever it is, and then with approaching age and all the abilities that come with that and so on, the same thing that you were reading as a student, it seems to change when you take it again. It seems to have changed. It's almost like the picture of Dorian Gray or something. There's something that, like, a closed book has this ability to mercurially transform itself. Next time you look at it, you see more and more things. All right, now the thing about Hamlet is the gender issues in it. Okay, in terms of dark women, we can call Gertrude dark because we're not really sure about her. Okay, it's not that she's a negative figure; she's not one of a femme fatale figure or a destructive, you know, figure in any way. It's just that we're never really sure about her. Production has a number of options there. It's not really clear, for example, from the play whether did Gertrude in fact start her sexual relationship, okay, with Claudius before her first husband was dead or not? Okay, we're not really sure. Hamlet is suspicious about it, okay, and his suspicions about his mother combined with his hatred for his uncle, you know, make him, you know, turn against Ophelia at the slightest provocation, just trash her. Here is like a beautiful young couple that should be together. It should be the future of the realm, the future of the Danish royal house. And instead, it's all ruined, all destroyed, all falls to nothing. And it's just every time you go to the play, you think, oh, this time, yes, this time Hamlet, Ophelia will go, yes, but no, okay, no, the play won't let that happen, okay. But Gertrude, I mean, I feel that. And then Hamlet has these, I'll talk about it in a second, Hamlet has these like these long, these recitatives of hatred of women, suspicion of women and so on, coming from his sense of betrayal by his mother. There is a blurred borderline between Hamlet and his mother. I mean, there's no doubt about it. I mean, Hamlet is way too concerned, okay, with his mother's sex life. Absolutely way too concerned, all right? In fact, to the point of, speak of hallucinatory imaginings. I mean, it's almost like he's right there at the bedside, almost like the camera eye, you know, sometimes, talking about his mother's sex life. I've always felt, from the prose, the quality of the prose that Gertrude speaks, that she should be played by a big woman. Okay, that the actress should have some meat on her bones. Okay, Julie Christie, who played her once, I adore Julie Christie from Darling and so on. But Julie Christie was a little bit too beautiful and too electric and so on. No, I think that Gertrude is rather indolent. Okay, she's sensual. She loves to eat, to drink, to lie around, to have sex, and so on. And she, in the scene in her closet, as much as acknowledges this, that she's been weak, you know, that she's given too much license to her own sexual impulses, etc. And I feel she's a little slow. Okay, she's slow. Okay, she's slow to process, and I think that's important, especially when Hamlet is rebuking her and berating her and in her face and like that, and she's kind of slow and trying to take it in and not quite. And so something we can hold against Hamlet is the sadistic way he uses his own verbal skills. Okay, as an intellectual. Against women, okay? He uses it as a defense means. You see that again and again as he trashes and slashes, you know, Ophelia and Gertrude. But like, I want to bring your attention, you probably are aware of it, but this the first time we hear Hamlet's inner thoughts, okay? Of course, he's been sulking on stage in the beginning, silent, you know, off to one side during Claudius's address to the court. And then we get him alone, and we have that first soliloquy. Okay, and I find it absolutely amazing in terms of this theme that we're talking about darkness. Okay, dark women and the dark visions of woman in the Shakespeare plays. This is the soliloquy that goes, "Oh, that this too sullied flesh would melt, thaw, and resolve as I've been doing." So he goes on. Hamlet goes on talking about, "Oh, if only I could commit suicide." All these very abstract philosophical terms, okay, and then he uses the imagery of a garden. Oh, the world is like a garden to me, but it's now a total, you know, it should be beautiful and well maintained, orderly. Instead, it's fallen to pieces. This is, of course, because of the gardener, the master gardener, his father, the king, is gone, and everything is there's been this collapse. Everything's a mess. An unweeded garden that grows to seed. Things rank and gross in nature possess it merely. It's overrun with rats and, you know, parasites and so on and so forth. Then there's this break. It's in the middle of a line. Okay, the middle of a line. This is like incredible. No, there had been nothing like this in the whole history of literature. Okay, where this sudden turn. Here's Hamlet talking in this abstract philosophical way up here, and then all of a sudden this welling thing comes up from the unconscious. This, Freud said, you see, he was a reader of the poets and of Shakespeare, and Freud said that the poets had preceded him in the invention of the unconscious, and this is one of the great examples of it. And it, all of a sudden, in the middle of a line, okay, it turns, okay, he goes, Daddy shall come to this, but 2 months dead, nay, not so much, not two, okay, so excellent a king, that was, he goes on and on about now his mother and his father, okay, and it gets worse and worse, okay, he goes on talking about, must I remember? Okay, she would hang on him, and so on. Frailty, the name is woman. Okay, and so on. To get this like obsessive, sudden focus on his mother. Okay, and on his mother's relationship with his father. This personal stuff and all of this buried negativity just erupts. And then beyond that, it then focuses totally on his mother. He talks about how she was faking it at the funeral, at the service, when they're following my father's body to the graveyard. She was faking her tears, okay? She obviously she didn't mean it because she married my hated uncle, so quickly, all right? And then, okay, it's almost like a great camera, that comes in, focuses down. What am I thinking of? Oh, I'm thinking of Notorious, okay, where Hitchcock's camera is like over the party scene, and then kind of slowly swoops down until you see the key being held in Ingrid Bergman's hand, okay, all right. It's a little bit like that, okay, where we're way up here, and then the camera's coming down, and so all of a sudden we're in the bedroom, his mother's bedroom, okay. This is in the first soliloquy, okay, right at the very beginning of the play, and he goes, okay, within a month, ere yet the salt of most unrighteous tears had left the flushing in her gallid eyes, she married. Oh, most wicked speed to post with such dexterity to incestuous sheets. Now, the actor should be spitting on the front rows, in those lines, because it's like incredible, all right? And where we are is that we're in the bedroom, okay? And we have his mother being represented as a horse, you see? A horse who, we still have that phrase somewhat in the States. Do you have hot to trot? Okay, all right? She's hot to trot, okay? All right? She's posting. She's an animal driven only by animal urges, okay? And galloping, 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 okay? And leaping over people and all barriers to get into the bed, okay? And we're not just in the bed. We are there, right there, because we see the actual sheets, and we see the incestuous sheets, okay, all right, meaning they're somewhat soiled, from that. Now, this whether it is technically incest that his mother married, her brother-in-law, different centuries, different cultures have had a different judgment about it. Certain cultures did regard it as incest, others not. Others thought it was the obligation of a man to marry to help a widow along. Okay, so there are other such passages in the play, all right. But this obsessive focus where we are way too close, okay, almost like an apparition. Okay, we are way too close. It's almost like we're in a motel. Okay, in fact, what I'm thinking of Hitchcock again. Okay, opening of Psycho. Okay, yes. Okay, all right. We're coming into Phoenix. Okay, and you see the hotel, and all of a sudden we like swoop through the window of this like seedy hotel, and there is okay Janet Leigh. Okay, having her in lunchtime sex. Okay, and you have to get back to the office quick. Yes, and there's Janet Leigh, and her brassiere was completely unheard of. Just to see that at the time, and there we are. Okay, in this completely illicit, in this room with illicit sex, it's somewhat like that, okay? This feeling of, we're uncomfortably close, okay, to a scene that of almost, it's almost decadent. It's almost decadent, how close we are brought, okay, to this. So this is, this issue of can women be trusted, okay, it's a theme that runs throughout the play, Hamlet. And of course, it's especially when Hamlet is berating poor Ophelia, okay, in that the scene where when he realizes that they're being spied on by her father, and that Ophelia has betrayed him. And he goes on, and just absolutely, this is the start of Ophelia's mental breakdown. I mean, just this she's just a delicate and loving girl, very simple, rather noble. She speaks beautifully, even when Hamlet's abusing her, she speaks well of him, and he's just, I've heard of your paintings. Okay, God hath given you one face, and you make yourselves another. You jig and amble, you lisp, you nickname God's creatures, and make your wantonness your ignorance. Go to, I'll know why you have made me mad. And goes on, okay, about this, that how women using makeup, using cosmetics, enhancements, the way women walk, okay, and that slight, which is actually, it's because of the pelvic construction and the legs being slightly far apart, okay, because of childbirth. And so there's just a slight, that, in all of that. So what Hamlet is accusing women of here, okay, is of exploiting men, okay, of domineering over men, of appealing, making direct appeals to men's sexual desires, okay, in order to control them, in order to lie to them, okay. You know that this is what they say about the stiletto heel, the high heel, the stiletto heel. Actually, it is kind of a sexual aid, because what it does is it forces women's hips to do that even more. It's impossible to walk, you can't walk like a soldier in stiletto heels. Okay, so there's that swaying, seductive thing. Now, the reason why these things are important, it seems to me, okay, is because it's not just in art that we find these things, okay? It's also in crime, okay? The history of psychopathology, right? To understand the criminal, to understand the criminal psychotics visualization of women that's leading to attacks on women constantly all over the world, you have to read great literature and art to understand human motivation, okay? So I am very concerned about this political trend in academe, okay? That has led to this present situation where now we have the Obama administration and the Democratic Party I'm a member of, and so on, about the war on women, and we need more sexual harassment rules, more guidelines, more committees, more. Excuse me, okay, that's not my view, okay? My view is that women have to open their eyes, okay, and men who love women must also open their eyes, okay, to the one man in a thousand, okay, who's the criminal psychotic and who visualizes women in exactly these terms. This is the truth. When Hamlet is abusing Ophelia, that is the way the criminal psychotic is viewing women on the street, the stranger woman, okay? And this is leading, I mean, I just on the way here, okay, I'm reading yet more reports, okay, about yet another, undergraduate girl, this one at the University of Virginia, is coming back from a bar, and she's drunk, and she's on her heels, and she's, like, alone, and so on, and she gets snatched, okay, and they can't find her, et cetera, et cetera. This is happening, like, every week, it seems to me, and there's no discourse whatever about this, except that people say, we need more committees. We need more. No, you cannot retrain the mind of the criminal psychotic. Now, I have no idea why I can understand, okay, criminal psychotic. I don't know, okay? But I, because I have read so much literature and art, and because I take these passages seriously, okay, I understand this feeling of betrayal and defraudment, and women have too much power. They have too much power over me, okay? I must capture them. I must exterminate this, and so on. This is a recurrent pattern, okay, in human life. And until women return, okay, to studying literature, they will not be able to understand, okay, the potential for danger in the environment. Okay, so do you think that Dostoevsky is being assigned these days? Okay, things that are about evil, or about huge conflicts of the human soul. Okay, we're living in a very secular age right now, where the talk of evil is considered naive. That this somehow a discourse that belongs to fundamentalist evangelical Christians living in Tennessee or something. Okay, and so on. In other words, there's no sense of the evil has been revised to mean only social injustice, okay? But there is evil, and there are criminals who enjoy evil, enjoy destruction. Okay, and you only can find it in literature and art, or actually great films. I mean, you can Psycho. The whole of Psycho is about this. It was based on a case, okay, an actual case that was far more gruesome, okay, than Hitchcock could possibly have filmed. Okay, and all kinds of ritualistic dismemberments of women and flaying of the skins of women and so on. That it sounded like an Aztec cult going on. It was somewhere in was it Minnesota? The guy Ed Gein, I believe his name was. I think it was Minnesota. Okay, is where he was living in a cabin. And it was this book about him. Okay, that inspired Hitchcock to do that film. All right, so all of these things are unpalatable. People still feel in this now. Liberal people today, you know, humanitarian people feel human nature is fixable. Okay, and someday we'll have this again utopian future that we are moving along, and every year, okay, we're becoming better people, and the day will come when we'll be able to, you know, make sure that women are never attacked or men are not attacked, and there'll be no. This is not what I see. I see tremendous forces of the irrational in the human psyche. Okay, and the Greeks had it right. You have the forces of, you know, of light, of, you know, of the rational, always in contest with. Always, okay, the forces of the irrational. That's what it means in the great temple pediment at Olympia, where you have Apollo, who is representing reason, okay, throwing out his arm in order to quell, okay, these animal forces which are erupting. There's a great a scene of the attack of the centaurs upon a banquet of women. It actually is an attack. It's all about attack on women, and about I believe that. Human beings are half animal. Okay, there's a bestial, primitive part of the brain. Okay, that most people is educable. Okay, but in a small number of people is not. Okay, and therefore, you know, an intelligent woman prepares herself to defend herself in the world against the one who is ineducable as much as toward the 99 who are, you know, who want to be good men. Okay, so now let me move on to Macbeth. Oh, this it's incredible. We can see the Lady Macbeth is one of the great characters, one of the great villainesses of world literature. There are parallels to her. Medea would be, you know, the earliest, and then her heirs would be like Ibsen's Hedda Gabler and so on. It's phenomenal. But what needs to be addressed in Macbeth is the issue of the witches. Okay, the witches who begin the play. And who seem to have some control over the universe? Okay, do the witches determine natural law, or are they simply like prophetesses or sibyls, able to read the signs? And then who is in charge of the universe? It doesn't seem as if there is a principle of justice in the universe. And so how do we have these women, these crones? Okay, women actors love to play these roles. They're a hoot. Okay, because there's a kind of comedy and kind of stomping around, and people can do a lot of drama with it. There's something seductive, okay, about, despite the fact that they're crones. Okay, they clearly seduce Macbeth, okay, into, because of his own dreams of power. He keeps on returning to them, compulsively. The witch. Now, in second wave feminism, there was more talk of it at the very beginning, in the late 60s, early 70s, and so on. Susan Sontag wrote a little bit about this, about the aging woman. Now, it seemed to me that the second wave, feminist view of this was it was simplistic, as much, saying every the representing an aging woman as a witch is prima facie misogynist. Okay, because witches don't really exist, and so on. And this is just a way that men have stereotyped women and kept them back, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, it was the same response that second wave feminism had toward, the Playboy Club. Gloria Steinem went to expose it with her 1 month of whatever she was doing there, and so on. And I just thought it was completely wrong. Okay, I thought that was wrong also. Right, but the point is, the aging woman really is a little bit uncanny. Hello. Okay. All right. Why? It's because all human beings are a combination of both hormones. Right? There's a certain balance, and young men, when they're in their late teens and their 20s, have testosterone levels above women's testosterone levels, something like anywhere from 8 to 10 to 20 times. Okay. But as you know, when women reach menopause, their estrogen level drops, and what happens is that their androgen level, the testosterone level, you know, is unopposed, and so you get this strange thing where, as men age, they become less masculine, because their hormone levels drop. But women, many women, okay, become more masculine, okay, because their estrogen level drops. All right. So what you're getting, and that is why you have the witch at Halloween with those whiskers and so on, and why witches are often shown as bearded, is because that is an effect of androgen in the body. All right. So what I would like to say is that this is a world phenomenon that has been observed by all peoples, okay, that aging women and old women can be fierce, okay, and scary, and the ones who like are starting to have Alzheimer's and, you know, senile dementia, but still have their bodies intact and so on, are ferocious. I mean, I can still remember, you know, when I was in junior high school, okay, there was like a house, okay, there was a widow in the house, an old widow, okay, who would peek out her window, and you had to hurry up past her house and so on, okay. So there was like this thing about the old woman has power, has certain kind of strange power and a certain kind of fanaticism, okay, that the old man doesn't have. And I myself, you know, just as a social observer, so many of my ideas are based on what I hear going on around me on the street or in shopping malls and so on. How many times have I heard, okay, you know, there'll be an older couple, an old married couple going along, and I will hear, okay, behind me or in the restaurant, I'll hear the woman saying to the man, "No, you can't have that. Stop it." Okay, and so on. All right, and just taking him along, and the man is just going along, and he's become totally docile. He doesn't have any hormones left. Okay, and he has indeed become a second child. Okay, and so on. And the women still are opinionated and etc. Okay, all right. So back to the witches of Macbeth. Okay, so on. All right, they know all, see all. Okay, the witches. All right. Now, the thing is, okay, that what's very interesting about this play is that Macbeth has all this ambition, obviously, and then betrays the most fundamental laws of hospitality, of loyalty to king, okay, as well as of a host to a guest and so on by the slaughter of the king in order to, you know, become king. But what Shakespeare shows is this strange exchange of power that goes back and forth between him and between Macbeth and Lady Macbeth. It's remarkable. And Lady Macbeth, she's one of the most powerful female characters in all of literature, but she is only strong when he is weak, all right? When she's on her own, she falls apart. Okay, do you notice it's a symbiosis between the two of them? Okay, there was nothing like this, you know, in literature before. There were powerful, you know, mythological women destroyers. Okay, but nothing like this, where you're having this kind of reciprocity and this exchange of power back and forth. Okay, in a married pair, and it looks forward to, of course, whatever happened, or Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf. Okay, and if anyone here has not seen that movie, okay, with Richard Burton and Elizabeth Taylor, I really recommend it, because you can really see this, you know, this back and forth, this sparring, this sense of a kind of a claustrophobic relationship, okay, a codependent relationship with all kinds of psychological violence, you know, going on in it, et cetera. But this is remarkable, because Macbeth is a soldier, okay, who finally redeems himself at the end after Lady Macbeth has committed suicide, and we respect him again when he goes down fighting. He won't surrender, and so on and so forth. So he has all the valor and the physical power of a soldier, but yet he seems to be kind of melting inside. He has the heart or soul of a poet sometimes. Okay, he's too sensitive, and you have one of the classic scenes. And again, a scene totally proving that, that these plays were written by an actor, by a man of the theater, by a director, a producer, and so on. The scene in the banquet hall where Macbeth is supposed to be presiding as king, okay, with the courtiers there, and instead he keeps on seeing in the empty chair Banquo's ghost, and so on. No one else can see Banquo's ghost except him and his wife struggling to keep everything together, struggling and horrified by his self-exposure, by the kind of, it's almost a hysterical kind of self-destruction, that Macbeth is unfortunately victim of there. All right. So now, what else? Okay, these witches, this supernatural. Okay, does the supernatural exist? I mean, clearly the witches tell the truth. But obviously the witches themselves are cruel and playing tricks and games and don't tell the entire truth. So you have these visions they're able to summon up. Of course, this was a play that was not for the general stage. It wasn't for the globe. It was for the court of James. And therefore, you have this this use of special effects. Okay, in a way, it's kind of sad because those techniques that Shakespeare is employing there, of the special effects that we are now able to do through digital animation and so on and so forth. It is the end of his own genre. Okay, the emergence of mask, MASQUE, mask as the new form of the age following Shakespeare. It's not for the general audience. It's not for the mixed audience in the public stage. It's for an aristocratic crowd, and we're moving toward the kind of aristocratic fun and games of the court of the French king. But actually, it's also the birth of opera. So we can say that mask, the emergence of aristocratic mask, did kill. The kind of theater that Shakespeare's generation had developed to such perfection. On the other hand, it was the beginning of a great form that's still very vibrant. All right, so let me move on to, because I'm afraid I'm going to run out of time, let me move on quickly to Antony and Cleopatra. Now, Cleopatra. This play is unplayable. People cannot find a Cleopatra. That's the point. Okay, who can do this? Okay, who really can play the role of Cleopatra as Shakespeare wrote it? There have been many attempts, including by Tallulah Bankhead, who was a star, who was the toast of the London and New York stage in the 1920s, and she tried this role. And I believe the review said something like, Tallulah Bankhead barged down the Nile last night and sank. Okay, I mean, that was. And then another one of my favorite ones was, well, this is about 30 years ago now. This was reported of an actor and a director talking and something like that, saying, I heard Janet Sussman is going to be, who's a great actress, I heard Janet Sussman is going to be playing in Antony and Cleopatra. And the other person said, who's she playing? Anno Barbis? Okay, all right. I mean, it was like a soldier, and so on. All right. Meaning, Janet Sussman as Cleopatra. It's very, very difficult to imagine, because Cleopatra is, after all, a historical character. Although we think of her through the way Shakespeare presents her, exactly like Julius Caesar. Okay, Julius Caesar. It's impossible for us not to think of the real Julius Caesar as Shakespeare imagines him. And sometimes people say, what if Shakespeare had written a play about Pompey? Who thinks about Pompey? Pompey is like a footnote in history, but Pompey was very important, and Julius Caesar's son-in-law and rival, and a life very interesting, but he's totally erased from history, except if you were a student of Roman history. It's because Shakespeare didn't bother to do a play about him. That's why. But now, Cleopatra, the mystery about Cleopatra's character, the mythology about her certainly started being pumped out. It was propaganda after Octavius Caesar defeated Mark Antony and Cleopatra at Actium, and they committed suicide the next year. So Cleopatra's reputation was she was like maligned as a whore, and there's no doubt that there's a certain kind of Puritanism among the upper class, patrician class in Rome. Julius Caesar was an example of that himself. that is just never shown in movies. I mean, it gets me furious the way movies about Rome show it as decadent and simply brutally militaristic, and are completely missing the actual the puritanical gravitas and the dignity and high moral values of the upper class. I mean, there were certain, obviously there were exceptions, but those women of the Mideast. Okay, it's not just Cleopatra. It's the women of Babylon. Look at the way the women of Babylon are portrayed in the Bible. Okay, they were highly sophisticated women, and they end up as the whore of Babylon. Okay, they're like sort of the symbol of everything that is against the Hebrew view of God as pure spirit and turning away from the sensuality of the earth and so on. And we simply know how the aristocratic women of Egypt looked like. That's why I began my last book, Glittering Images, with a painting from the tomb of Queen Nefertari, the wife of the great Rameses II. And the women were wearing these gorgeous transparent linen gowns revealing the body and so on. So this kind of open sensuality, acceptance of the body in that kind of semi-tropical climate definitely made Europeans think of Mideastern women as harlots. Right? So what Shakespeare is doing here is in some sense trying to reclaim Cleopatra's image, but he is unflinching in demonstrating that that it's Antony's tragedy. Antony, okay, is unable to maintain his Roman personality, his responsibilities. He is a triumvir. He has responsibilities for people outside himself. And time and again, Cleopatra in the play tries to get Antony to do his duty and to pay attention to business. And Antony prefers to play. Okay, and that is indeed part of Mark Antony's legend, that he was a carouser. The men loved him. The soldiers loved him. He loved to drink and party all night long and so on. He was a robust soldier. So the issue really is Antony's responsibility, Antony's failures, and we see moments where Antony feels that his own psychology, his own personality is melting away, okay, in a way that's like the sensibility of a poet or an artist. But Cleopatra, what can we say? I mean, Cleopatra was regarded as a villainess in Shakespeare. She was on the bottom of the list in terms of admired characters in Shakespeare throughout the 19th century, obviously, okay, the Victorian period, which made saints out of women like Cordelia, Desdemona, and so on, who are like pure and simple and pious in a kind of 19th century manner. And everything about Cleopatra seemed trashy and sinful and so on. It's really only post-Hollywood, post the period of the Hollywood stars, that we see Shakespeare's essentially cinematic conception. I mean, in fact, even the structure of this play is cinematic. Right? This play was thought to be a mess in terms of its design because of the for a long time until Hollywood, okay, because of that skipping back and forth over hundreds and sometimes a thousand miles, scene, that just was not done, okay. So with Shakespeare, and we don't even notice it. We don't notice any problem with it, whatever, all those breaks, because we have been trained, okay, through movies of like just end of a scene, suddenly we're 1,000 miles away, or in a space outer space movie, like 10,000 miles away. It doesn't bother us at all. The Shakespeare's failure to conform to the Aristotelian unities, which the French critics always held against him. The French have always been very snobbish about Shakespeare. Okay, so.